Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Hope Christian Church. We are glad to have you. If you are visiting us for the first time, we hope you come back. Make sure you visit the desk on this side called the Hub. We have a gift for you if it's your first time here. Today, they say forewarned is forearmed, right? I've had a very emotional week. I lost my spiritual papa, God-given, not my papa by blood, but my spiritual papa. I was blessed by God with him. Such wisdom, such love for Jesus, such compassion. He was such a cheerful giver. He's really fresh. He passed away suddenly on Monday. So these songs today, a couple of them, the words are really near and dear to my heart, so I might be perfectly fine, but I might just be pure raw emotion up here. So just letting you guys know, I apologize in advance. You've seen me cry up here before. It's not the first time, but I'm like really, really sad. That is the truth. I have joy in Jesus because I know where he is, and I know I'm going to see him again. But in the flesh, I'm very sad, so... just letting you all know, it's okay. You keep singing. If I lose it, you keep going. But thank you. Isn't it beautiful that even in the midst of our pain and our sadness, we can still have joy? Because we know who our joy comes from. So, you know, if you feel like it, stand up and let's praise the Lord. I really need you all today, so... been lost, seen the water get troubled, but we walked across. When my knees were shaking, you held my hand, turning my problems to a promised land. The young good shepherd, I'll follow all my days. There ain't nothing sweet to watch you make a way. You've walked me through the valley, but you never steer me wrong. So lead on, good shepherd, lead on. Through some mighty deep canyons that you brought me through, through some mighty big mountains that just up and moved. Glory, glory, but you never stood me. that beautiful to know that God never changes? He never changes. No matter what our circumstances are, He is the same God yesterday, today, and forever. Amen. I'm calling on the God of Jacob, whose love endures through generations. I know that you will keep your covenant. I'm calling on the God of Moses, the one who opened up the ocean. I need you now to do the same thing for.
The captives. Good morning. You can be seated. Hey, it is so great to be here today and to worship our awesome God. And he's the same God. Isn't that neat? Isn't that cool and amazing? He is the same God that you read about many years ago. He is a faithful God. And if you look around, it's like, man, what's all this decoration stuff going on here? VBS is coming up this week. And so if you know of some, you have children, grandchildren, you know of some children, make sure they know about VBS that starts this week. So be in prayer for that. Also, that it'll be an opportunity to reach out and help others. Hey, wasn't it good? Last week, the coffee ministry was not able to be here because they were at the fair all week and tearing down and getting back up here. Wasn't it great to have them back out there this morning? Hey, how about that? Just give them a hand of appreciation. Makes my job a little easier so that people stay awake when I'm trying to preach. You know what I'm saying? Got that coffee in them. But it is so good to be here. If you're a first-time guest with us, we really want to make you welcome. And I know when you come to a new place, you don't know what to expect, but I'll tell you, do not expect perfect people. We try. Oh, we try. But we just can't seem to find them. You would think we'd find some perfect people, but no, we're all a mess trying to find God. But yeah, we're just not perfect. Like even my friend Scott Gold, you would think that that guy was perfect, but you know, he was a king, King Gold. And King Gold, believe it or not, he was a cruel king. I know it's hard to believe, but he was. And so one day his advisor, John D'Amigo, came in and gave him some bad advice. And so King Gold said, that's it. I'm throwing you to my dogs for them to tear you up. And so the advisor, John, said, but please, King Gold, I have served you 10 years, and this is the first time I've ever gave you any bad advice. And can you please have mercy on me? And King Gold said, no. No, throw him to the dogs, these ferocious dogs that I have. So anyway, the advisor, John, said, please, give me 10 days. Just give me 10 days. So, you know, even though he wasn't very merciful, he was curious. Why does he want 10 days? So he gives him 10 days. So the advisor, John, he goes over to the dog keeper and says, let me feed these dogs for the next 10 days. So sure enough, John goes in, he feeds the dog for the next 10 days. Oh, he pets those dogs. He plays with those dogs. He brings them treats and everything else. So the 10 days run out, and King Gold said, it's time to throw the advisor to the dogs. And sure enough, they throw John down, the dogs, and the crowds all gathered around. You know how they like to watch violence and everything. And they were amazed. All these dogs come running over to John. They're licking on him and playing around. And King Gold says, what happened to my vicious dogs? And John says, I served these dogs for 10 days, and look what they do for me. I served you for 10 years. Can you not have any mercy on me? And King Gold sat there and he learned his lesson. So the next day he replaced the dogs with crocodiles. So some are just not perfect, all right? Sometimes we just mess up in life and we need a perfect Savior in our lives. So, but it is great to be here today and to worship our awesome God. I guess there's a Bible Bowl meeting right after church. I need to just throw that in there. So,
right after church, anybody who's interested in Bible Bowl, if you can't be there, just sit down or ask someone. We'll make arrangements. Just kind of a payment.
Okay, so keep that in mind. Also, welcome to the Church on the Hill. We had to reschedule it. Whew, July is crazy here at Hope Christian Church. Absolutely nuts crazy. And so we moved it to August the 18th. It's an opportunity for you to meet the staff here at the church, meet the elders, and just get an idea what the church is about. And we feed you lunch. It's always a good lunch after a worship service. So you can sign up for that. There'll be sign-up sheets in the lobby on both sides and also online. And so that gives you that opportunity. That is August the 18th. So we invite you to do that. You know, it is good to be able to come together and to worship our God. And I love what the psalmist wrote here in Psalms 150, verse 6. He said, let everything that has breath praise the Lord, praise the Lord. And we have a lot to be thankful for. It's good to see Hunter back there. We've been praying for him. He fell off, I don't know if it was 20, 30 foot cliff and had some damage done, and he is back there today. And so that's great to see God's healing power in his life, and we're thankful for that. We have a lot to be thankful for. And our job as Christians, and we'll hear about in the sermon today, is to be ambassadors and to stand for what Jesus says. And so, you know, we want to do that in our community. We do it through different ways. Even the use of this facility, it gets used a lot by our community and so forth and so on, because we just want to be a light in our community is what we want to do. And when you give in our offerings, that's a way that some of that happens. And so that's part of our worship, because God, as we talked about last week, the heart of a giver. And so, you know, we want to make sure that our heart is right with God. It's not about all these money we can take in. And a matter of fact, as leaders, we ask you to pray for us. This church belongs to Jesus, and it's his church, and we want to do what he says, whether it be with the funds or whatever. We want to be faithful to him. And so there's different ways you can give there, but we want to give God thanks for the offerings at this time. So let's bow our heads for prayer. Father, you are an amazing, awesome God, and thank you for that rain yesterday. Appreciate that so much, and we know you're going to send more because you're a faithful God, but mostly you're faithful to us as your children, and I thank you for that. And God, you bless us and help us to be a blessing to others. No matter what gifts you have given us, help us to use them to bring you glory. Because we love you, God, and we thank you that you love us and you're patient with us. Mercy, I thank you for that. And so, God, I pray that you would just bless these offerings and that we would do what you would have us to do with them. God, we give you all praise and all glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Stand up, make someone welcome, and say, you know, God is much more merciful than King Gold, all right?
After this song, we are going to share communion. We do hold communion every week. So if you didn't grab your elements on the way in, we have them on the side tables and at the table in the back. So during this song will be a good time for you to grab those. Beth is going to lead us into communion.
Morning, guys. Morning. If you hear him lower the volume, like, that's because I'm kind of loud. Let me see. I'm trying to do two things at once. I'm not very good at that. Wives are way better at doing multiple things at once. I'm a firm believer in that. So Dave kind of talked about being ambassadors for Christ and how we can do that within the county and A couple weeks ago, I had the wonderful opportunity of sitting at the booth representing Hope Christian Church, but representing Jesus' church, giving people the free gift of that Jesus has given all of us, salvation. Which, you know, ties to what we're talking about, which I guess I don't know if someone mentioned it or not, but we got these little cups here, loaf on the top, juice in the bottom, sides, back. If you want to grab that now while I'm talking, you can. But had that opportunity, which was really awesome, to kind of see people come up to a booth and just have just a little bit of curiosity about Jesus. I mean, like whether they were, hey, I believe in Jesus or I follow Jesus, which I think some of us have a pretty good idea that there's a difference between believing in Jesus and following Jesus. So anyway, it was really cool. I've actually got an employee who lives, I don't want to like outright call him out, but he lives a non-Christian lifestyle, doesn't know Jesus, doesn't have Jesus in his heart, and was never really introduced to Jesus. And then we've had a few conversations, but anyway, he came up to the booth with him, I want to say a friend of his, and two other friends of his. I say that with, in case you can't see my little air quotes. But they knew exactly what the booth was all about, all right? So, like, you can see Bibles all over the place, kids' Bible books. Of course, there was some secular stuff, like crayons and stuffed animals. But he knew what was there, and so did his buddies. They saw, so I didn't feel the need to throw Jesus down their throat. But what was interesting enough is he came back again. And he came back this time with his kids. And, yeah, sure, you can logically say, oh, well, he just wanted his kids to meet the guy who writes him a check every week. Sure, great. Or the Holy Spirit's moving in this guy's heart because it was so cool. Two of the kids, the older kids, yeah, they're looking at the table. They're like, yeah, I'm not interested in any of that. I'm going to grab a stuffed animal. So the two of them grab a stuffed animal. Now, a little bit of context. I was able to fit, like, most all the whole table with books. Like I said, there were some crayons and stuff, but it was all Jesus-related stuff, whether it be devotions, journals, Bibles, whatever. So his two oldest kids glossed right over all three of the kids glossed right over the table, didn't want none of that. Two oldest kids grabbed stuffed animals. Well, there was one book I could not fit on that table, and it was a Jesus kids book, and I think it was Bedtime Stories or something. His youngest daughter grabbed that book. Like, I don't... You can logically line it up and say, oh, well, it's just coincidence. But, man, I really think, like, the Holy Spirit's knocking on this guy's heart. And he's not living a Christian lifestyle. And he is just now starting to get intrigued by Jesus. And he may never really fully commit to Jesus. But Jesus is trying to reach out to this guy regardless of where he's at in life, is what my point is. And, you know, this is, you know, the Lord's Supper that we have is based off of the what Jesus had talked about at the Last Supper. And you guys can kind of see where I'm getting to. And I might step on some of y'all's toes, and I apologize for that. Not really. I saw what you guys saw at the opening ceremony of the Olympics. I'm not going to sugarcoat it. What troubled me more than anything was, as Dave said, we're ambassadors for Christ, was some of the response that was come out of ambassadors from Christ. And the reason, and I felt troubled without really getting into Scripture, so it really encouraged me to get into Scripture and see, how did Jesus respond to mockery? I know one story that Dave talked about not too long ago with the adulterous woman that was brought out by the Pharisees. She was caught in we saw her doing it. Jesus, you're the man who made the law of Moses. What do you say? They're mocking him. Like, they were mocking him in that instance, saying, what are you going to do about it, lawmaker? You made the law. What are you going to do about it? He did nothing. He did nothing at all. He said, he stayed silent and instead showed that woman mercy. And in a more prevalent instance, which through my research, I found that it is in 2 out of 3 Gospels that it explicitly talks about the mockery of Jesus on his way up to the cross. And I just want to share with you that passage, if you don't mind. Let's see. Oh, you're going to have to excuse me. I'm not always the most prepared, but I had it here in Matthew, I promise. Right here, I believe. Yes. Yeah, so starting Matthew 27, about verse 27. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters, and they gathered the whole battalion before him. And they stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. And twisting together a crown of thorns, they put it on his head and put a reed in his right hand. And kneeling before him, they mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they spit on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him and led him away to crucify him. I know where I was at when Jesus came into my life. I know what's happened over the course of my following Jesus, and it hasn't always been pretty. And I don't want us to lose sight of the differences that, you know, some of us heterosexual people may have versus some people that don't live that same lifestyle. Jesus has paid it all for all of us. And I just want us to show that to the world, that I don't want one thing to dictate someone's image of Christ, because like that's what we're here to do, is to share Christ with everyone, not just straight people, not just people who live the same lifestyle as us. And that's way easier said than done. It's way easier said than done. But this blood covers it all. We were all made in His image, and He loves all of us. So I want to pray, and everyone take their own time to have, you know, communion, but just let us all remember where Jesus found us. And it wasn't pretty, and it's not always going to be pretty. Heavenly Father, I thank you for Jesus, for sending him down here to live the life that none of us could live. I can't go a day without needing his grace and his mercy. And I just thank you for sending the blemishless, blemish-free lamb to stand in the gap for me, to give me an opportunity at salvation, to give me an opportunity to grow in you, and to have a chance to have fellowship with people and to strengthen each other and to remind each other that it's all because of you. You covet our heart, Father, and I just pray that we can surrender each and every day to you and all of your promises. And I pray that we can remember your blood that covers all sin and your body that was broken for us. I pray these things in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen.
At this time, we're going to ask Rob Eaton to come forward. And as we see God's church, we see that each congregation is led by men who strive to follow Jesus, who are not perfect men, but often referred to as elders. Even that term follows pastors. And so it's a great task. And I often pray, God help none of us to desire this position so that we can have authority, or we think that we have power over things. God, help us always to have a servant's heart and to realize how much weight is on us when we stand before God to give an answer. And so as elders, we search around to say, you know, we're looking for godly men to fill that position. And so we approached Rob. And what I loved, I remember when we talked with him, his first question was, "Are we getting questions?" "Yeah, why me?" So that's one of the reasons right there, that humble spirit. And so I'm going to ask the other elders to come forward, and Rob's making his way up here, and we want to pray over him today. We got a couple scriptures we're going to read to set him apart as an elder, one who shepherds the flock of God. And that's an awesome responsibility, and oftentimes, I know these other guys will probably say what I feel, that, man, how many times we fail at it, and how many times we want to do better at it. So this time, Paul Lewis has a scripture he wants to read for us.
I'll be reading from 1 Timothy 3. "This saying is trustworthy. If anyone aspires to be an overseer, he desires a noble work. An overseer, therefore, must be above reproach, the husband of one wife, self-controlled, sensible, respectable, hospitable, able to teach, not an excessive drinker, not a bully, but gentle, not quarrelsome, not greedy. He must manage his own household completely and have his children under control with all dignity. If anyone does not know how to manage his own household, how will he take care of God's church? He must not be a new convert, or he might become conceited and incur the same condemnation as the devil. Furthermore, he must have a good reputation among outsiders so that he does not fall into disgrace in the devil's trap."
And now Now, Hebrews 13:17. Obey your leaders and submit to them, since they keep watch over your souls as those who will give an account, so that they can do this with joy and not with grief, for that would be unprofitable for you.
I'd like to ask you.
I'd like to ask all of you to bow your heads and go into prayer with me for Rob. Lord God, we just come together this morning as a congregation of your people. And we just, in unison of heart and mind, we come to you in prayer for Rob, who stepped up and agreed to become an elder. And I know that for many there's some trepidation about that. And Lord, you're looking for fearless men who will stand and in faith and who will have your name on their lips and your peace in their heart, Lord God, as they move forward in life. And I just want to thank you for Rob for stepping up for that. We're not perfect people by any means. And just being an elder doesn't make you automatically a perfect person. In many cases, it just makes you a target. And it adds extra responsibility and stress, Lord God, that needs to be bared up under. But you're a good God. And through your Holy Spirit and the power that it provides, you provide that strength. And so we just thank you for all that you do. We ask that your Holy Spirit would fill Rob. Give him the strength and the courage to continue to be that man on the battlefield. As he steps from the sidelines, many times we sit on the sideline and we look in and we see the game and how it's being played, and we can think something should have went this way or that way, but for people who's been in the game, people who have been on the field, you know that on the field you can't see everything that's going on. You can only see what's in front of you most of the time, and you can only follow what the coach asks you to do. And so, Father, we just ask that you give Rob that ability to follow what the coach ask him to do. If he stumbles and falls, if he fumbles the ball, help him to be the humble man that gets back up, continues to fight, continues to struggle, to stay strong in the faith. Father, through your grace and mercy and the power of your Holy Spirit that fills him and lives in his life, protect him, guide and direct him. Be with his family, Lord God, because this will also affect them. Just give them strength and mercy. Give Kim the grace that she's going to need in dealing with this with Rob as they walk through this together. Help her to be supportive of him and have her have the courage to be the woman and wife she needs to be as she walks through this with him. Father, we just ask a blessing on them both and on their family, Lord God, that you watch over and protect and guide, that you help Rob to be a leader that he needs to be, looking forward to the growth and the things that are going to happen here that you have planned, Lord God, that we don't even know yet and can't even imagine. As we step out in faith and do the things that you are asking us to do, Lord God, just be with him as he becomes one of their brother elders. Let the congregation find support with him and And we just ask everyone to be in prayer for all the leadership. Lord God, as the Apostle Paul called out, is to pray for us, that we can continue to work and do the things that need to be done, Lord God, in your name. And it is your name we ask, in the name of Jesus. Amen.
All right. Yes, I know some of you animal lovers just loved that right there. But did you notice that the word went out evidently that the king of the jungle had a message. And every animal came, even the bugs crawling on that limb right there. And they all came to listen to the king. And in this movie and other movies, they refer to the lion as the king of the jungle. And you may know some individuals in life that have that kind of respect in a particular group. And this is how Jesus should be viewed in the church. But is it? You know, a wonderful thing about our King and our Lord is this, that He is a faithful and loving God. And this morning, I'm looking around, there he is, Andy Harriet is here today, and we've been praying a long time for Andy because of his motorcycle accident. And some of y'all probably thought, did Dave forget him earlier? No, I just had my notes here to bring that up. And so we're thankful, man. I mean, I remember we went out to visit him in Morgantown, and he's just getting sharper. But the only problem is Sharon said he needs somebody to hit him over the head to make him listen. I said, that's your job. She said, yeah, and I'm doing it too. So anyway, well, we are so thankful to have Andy back here with us and in worship with us and as he continues to heal. And, if you've ever been around Andy, he's blessed by God. Very talented guy, machining things, amazing. What God does through him and gives him that gift. So, Andy, it's so great to have you back home with us here at Hope Christian Church. And that's the kind of God we serve. And so before we get into the message today, let's go to God in prayer. Father, you are an amazing God. And we're thankful for Jesus who gave his life for us. And Lord, I confess that many times I said, Jesus is my Lord, but is he really? Is he really? And help us as we look into the book of Revelation today at a message that Jesus gave the church and see how it applies to us today. God, I ask that you speak. I am so unworthy to be part of, even be part of your kingdom, nevertheless to be a spokesperson for you. And God, so we just ask that today you speak, your Holy Spirit minister to all of us in what we need to hear. In Jesus' name, amen.
Must be having some audio difficulties up there, sounds like, because that should have been coming on for our bumper. But actually, We're in this series, and this series to keep the lamp burning. And if you can read the book of Revelations, chapters like 1-3, and you will see that there's messages to seven churches, that Jesus gives this message to seven churches. And John says that he saw seven golden lampstands, and then he saw one like the Son of Man, and he describes the Son of Man and what he looks like. And he says that Jesus says the seven stars in his right hand he had, and a sharp double-edged sword coming from his mouth, and his face was shining like the sun. So Jesus then tells John not to be afraid. I'm like, yeah, it's kind of scary, you know, when you see something like that. And he tells John the seven stars are the angels or the messengers of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands are the seven churches. And remember that we said, if you remember back to when we started this series, that a lampstand is not the light itself, but a bearer of that light. That's what the church is supposed to be. And we looked at the church at Ephesus and the church of Smyrna. And today we take a look at the message that Jesus gave the angel to the church at Pergamum. And the message is entitled, Follow Only Jesus. Follow Only Jesus. Now, let's dig into this letter that Jesus is sending to this church there in Pergamum. Revelations 2:12. Revelations 2:12. To the angel of the church in Pergamum write, these are the words of him who has the sharp, double-edged sword. In these letters, Jesus always introduces himself in one way or another. And as I read this and thought about this, I struggled on what word to use or what words to use so much that I even, you know, to describe Jesus. It was just hard to come up how to describe him. So I said that Jesus is the commander. He is the commander. Say commander. All right. And as I said, when I begin to think, how do I describe Jesus? That is so weak. Even commander is so weak. I even try to create a word like authoritator, you know, like one who has all authority and everything. Because how, you know, he's been given all authority and he can enforce all authority. But how do you describe this omnipotent, all-powerful, supreme, almighty, awesome God? How can you do it? You just cannot do it. And the reason I could not find a word to truly describe him, first of all, is because he's indescribable, all right? He's just indescribable. When you try to imagine Jesus, he is indescribable. Words cannot do him justice. But also, I was reading the description he uses, and it just shouts out his unmeasurable strength. When he said, these are the words of him who has the sharp double-edged sword. And you might be thinking, well, what's the big deal? Say, what's the big deal, Dave?
What's the big deal, Dave?
Oh, some of y'all said that. There you go. Your coffee's kicking in. So anyway, yeah, what is the big deal? I mean, in Revelation chapter 1, John records that a sharp double-edged sword came from his mouth. Again, what's the big deal? But in the book of Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12, it reads, for the word of God is alive and is active. It is sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even into the dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. The imagery used here in Hebrews is popular, but easily misunderstood in our modern culture, as many times when we read. The Greek word translated sword is actually machera. A machera, often used generically for a sword or a dagger in the New Testament. However, the same word is also used to describe the blade wielded by Peter in Gethsemane when he cut off that guy's ear there in John chapter 18. Peter's weapon was less than a soldier's sword, but probably more of a large fisherman's knife, okay? Probably more of a large fisherman's knife. In fact, a fisherman's machara was primarily meant for cutting flesh, unlike the true military sword, which was a lot tougher, but not so much razor sharp. And whether military sword or machara knife, this perspective makes the metaphor of this verse all the more vivid. You can see it. You can just see. The sword is said to separate the joints and the marrow. Probably a reference to the tendons and the ligaments and other meaty parts. These tissues are hidden away in the body and hard to reach and seemingly indistinguishable. A sharp blade, such as a machera, can uncover and separate these things. And so, in the same way, the Word of God can separate spiritual things, which seems completely intertwined, such as the soul and the spirit. They seem so intertwined. And this isn't meant to be literal, but the Bible often uses terms interchangeably. Rather, this is a graphic explanation of how God's word can distinguish between the godly and the ungodly. The man, the soul, the spirit seem indistinguishable to us, but not to the word of God. This incredible cutting power of scripture that we see is a tool to separate our very thoughts from good and from evil. It can distinguish our heart. And the Bible provides everything we need to know the difference between selfless and spiritual deeds. Selfless and spiritual deeds and acts which are actually selfish or ungodly. In other words, sometimes to us, some people do certain things and they look to be godly, but really they're selfish. You know, it's to elevate that person. The Word of God is power. And that's what I'm trying to say. This Word of God, this sword, as I read that right there where I had studied on this. This Word of God coming from the mouth of God, basically it's saying Jesus is all in all, okay? He knows all things. He is all powerful. He can look into the deepest part of us and know who we are. And so, it matters what the king says, okay? He starts out by saying, basically, I am the king. I know the evil and the good. I have the power of the word. He is the word. So let's see what he says to this church. Now that he said this, it's like, whoa. And now he's writing to this church, and let's see what he says. Revelation 2:13. I know where you live, where Satan has his throne. Yet you remain true to my name. You did not renounce your faith in me, not even in the days of Antipas, my faithful witness, who was put to death in your city where Satan lives. The only words that matter, the words that Jesus gives, and part of this is this, it's good news. Good news. Say good news. Yeah, we'd all love to receive a letter from Jesus with some good news, wouldn't we? You know, saying some good things. We'd all love to do that. And Jesus here is saying, hey, I know where you live. I understand the evil that is all around you. It is like Satan's throne right there. You live in an evil place. And I found this when studying on this scripture here. And it says Pergamos, its location, it's primarily known for one thing, religion, all these different religions. On a hillside overlooking the city of the giant altar of Zeus, a throne of stone rising 40 feet in the air. On every corner, instead of finding a church, you would find a temple or an altar to a pagan god. It was primarily the center for the worship of the emperors. Religions of all kinds thrived in Pergamos. In fact, there is an ancient saying that whenever any kooky religious idea was expelled from some part of the world, it would find its place in Pergamos. Something that we must understand about ancient religions is that they are usually associated with immorality, these ancient religions. Prostitution, sodomy, orgies, and lewd entertainment. Thus, Pergamos was not only a religious city, it was a wicked city. And according to Jesus, it was the capital of Satan's kingdom. It was the location of the seat or throne. It was the place he lives, the place that Satan called home. But God had a light in the heart of Satan's kingdom. And to that congregation, he said, you remain true to my name. And I love this, that Jesus knows the name. This is Jesus now. Jesus is telling this angel, I want you to write this letter and get this. I love this. He knows this follower's name who followed him to his death, Antipas. You know, people don't go unnoticed in the eyes of Jesus. When you think I'm going unnoticed in the eyes of Jesus, no. And Jesus says, church, good news, even during these terrible times, you remained faithful. You did not cower. You did not back down. You did not shirk. You still stood for what was right. And so, There is good news from the commander. And so let's keep on reading. Revelations 2, 14 to 15. Nevertheless, don't like that word. Nevertheless, I have a few things against you. There are some among you who hold to the teachings of Balaam, who taught Balak to entice the Israelites to sin so that they ate food sacrificed to idols and committed sexual immorality. Likewise, you have those who hold to the teachings of the Nicolaitans. Here's some bad news. Say bad news.
Bad news.
Okay, we're not awake yet. Say bad news.
Bad news.
Yeah. Oh, man. Jesus is giving some bad news. We said when we started this series, some of the churches get good news and bad news. Some of them get good news only, and one of them get bad news only. That's not a good one. But anyway, here's some of the bad news. Balaam was an Old Testament prophet, okay? And you can read about him in Numbers chapter 22. And the Israelites had come to the borders of Moab, and they had just conquered the Amorites. And so the king, Balak, was scared. He's like, Israelites are coming for us next. They are coming for us next, man, and they're going to destroy us. So Balak sent messengers to Balaam, this prophet, to hire him to curse the Israelites. And before Balaam gave an answer to the messengers, he prayed to God and said, God, what should I do? And God told him that you're not to go with those messengers, nor are you to curse the Israelites. You're not supposed to do that. So Balaam told the messengers, no, go back home. And after the messengers went back and reported to Balak the king, they were sent back offering him more money. You know, raising the price. Come on, if you'll curse them, I'll raise the price. And so they come back, and then he was going to go with them. He was told to go with them, but don't do anything unless God tells you to. But along the way, here's this weird story in the Bible, okay? So along the way, an interesting story, how God uses a donkey to get his attention, all right? And so he's riding along, and this angel appears. He doesn't see it. The donkey sees this angel. And the donkey kind of backs up, stays out of the way. And Balaam, he gets mad and is beating the donkey. And finally, God speaks to the donkey. So the donkey's like, what are you beating me for? What is wrong with you, you know? And you're like, that's impossible. That's the most impossible thing I ever heard. That's why I can't believe the Bible. Hey, I'm just saying, if God created the donkey, he can make it speak if he wants to, all right? And he works in different ways. Why do we question God's greatness? You know, how he works. But then the angel appears to him and says, okay, you go ahead and go, but do not do anything. And what you just do what God tells you to do. And so the king keeps up in the money for Balaam. He said, but here's where Balaam fails. He goes to Balak and says, hey, I'll tell you what you can do. You can have your women, you can marry these guys, all right? And then they can infiltrate the Israelites. Uh-oh. And so he taught Balak to send his women to seduce the men of Israel to make them marry them. And it was the teachings that brought sin into Israel. And you can read about that in Numbers 31, 13 to 16. So if you start back there in Numbers 22 and read through there, you'll see this story. But then, so that's what he's talking about, you know, when he's saying, hey, you know, so he's saying, basically, somebody brought sin into the church, is what he's saying. Going about a roundabout way. Just like in the Old Testament, when that happened with Balaam, somebody brought that in somehow. And he said, then there's those who hold to the teachings of this Nicolaitans. And we talked about that about a month ago when we addressed the church at Ephesus, when he said, you Ephesians, you do not like the teachings of the Nicolaitans, and that's good. And we said, we don't know a whole lot about them. From the meaning of that word, it means conquering or subduing people. So there seems like there was some control over people. It was also believed that a man named Nicholas taught a doctrine of compromise and implying that total separation between Christianity and the practice of the occult or paganism wasn't essential. You can do both. You know, you can just add Jesus to your little brew there of your religion. And so Jesus is saying that the church in Pergamum has allowed worldly practices to creep into the church. And we read a few weeks ago how the church in Smyrna was being persecuted from or attacked from without. Now this church, Jesus is saying, it's coming from within. It's coming from within. Satan loves to plot. You know, the Bible talks about that when Paul says in Ephesians, you know, be careful, be alert to the strategies of the devil. You know, there are strategies. It's a spiritual realm. We're not in this little physical realm, man. There's some stuff going on in the spiritual realm, and we're all part of the spiritual realm. And so, man, what a letter. What a letter. But can't we see the same thing happening to the church in America today? Can we see it? Let's be honest. This letter could be written in the year of our Lord, 2024. And Jesus, would still say the same thing today. He, first of all, he notices what people go through. That's a blessing. That's a blessing. Jesus knows our struggles. He knows our struggles. He knows today what you're dealing with. That was the words of Jesus who talked about his faithful witness, Antipas. Jesus knew his name. He knew what he was going through. He knew what these people were going through. And if you're out there today and you're feeling struggles in your life, you're battling things and things are happening, I want to tell you that Jesus knows. If you're his child, he knows what you're going through. He understands what you're going through, and we can take that to heart today. And I love to read that when he calls Antipas by name and says he was my faithful witness. Woo! Wouldn't that make you feel good to hear it? I mean, Antipas, he's in heaven now, and he hears that Jesus has called him a faithful witness. It's like, wow. Now, I thought I was a nobody, man. You know, so Jesus doesn't forget us. Jesus sees the mess our country is in, and man, what a mess it's in. What a mess it's in. And he notices when the church is the church he wants us to be. He also notices that when the church stands above the fray. He notices when the church allows the world to dictate what is right and what is wrong, and that does not make him happy, happy, happy. I challenge you to go home and read Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1, and I warn you, it'll bring your spirits down, okay? But you'll go like, whoa, wow, I can see that. And so go home and read it. And you wonder, how can people be so blind today? How can there be so much blindness? And Paul writes in that book of Romans, God gave them over to the sinful desires of their hearts, and they have exchanged the truth about God for a lie. Wow, there it is. There it is. He also writes, they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, so God gave them over to a deprived mind so that they do not do what they so that they do what ought not to be done. Romans 1:32 says this. Romans 1:32, although they know God's righteousness decree that those who do such things deserve death, they not only continue to do these things but also approve of those who practice them. In other words, they're not only doing them themselves, but they're actually encouraging others to participate in this in the sinful lifestyle they're in. Yes, our world is in a mess. It is in a mess. As Seth mentioned about the Olympics and, you know, how tainted our world is. Now, God doesn't call us to be angry people. You know, I remember reading a book and studying with a group of people called Unoffendable, because in America, we all offended today. I mean, oh my goodness. Some of the stuff, the TV shows I used to watch growing up, people be like, oh, I can't believe they said that. You know, it's like, come on, grow up. You know, quit walking around like a little wimp that anything anybody says offends you. And there's a little trick to that that Satan's using, by the way. As we walk around and we gave everybody a trophy. Ah, poor kids. Everybody got to have a trophy so they don't know how to lose. You know, it's important in life to learn how to lose and how to win. And the measure of a person is finding out how to handle both of those, okay? That's the measure of a person. How do you win? How do you lose? How do you take it? Do you learn from it? That's what God is calling us to be. He's not calling us to be hateful people. Hateful people. The world is getting worse around us. It is. It's sneaking further and further away from God. Sexual perversion is on there, you know, it's just rampant. It's out there everywhere, everywhere. And, you know, you can do studies on pornography when some people say, oh, pornography doesn't hurt you. But they've talked and they've done brain studies and what it does to the brain of a person. And yet today, used to be in my day, if you wanted to go see pornography, you had to go in and rent some movie somewhere. You had to go buy some magazine. Oh, not today. It comes hunting for you, baby. You pick up your phone, you pick up your tablet, you're on the computer, and bam, there it is. Boom, there it is. Satan has done a good job at church. We can do a much better job because the Holy Spirit lives within us. And so, here's the problem. Here's the problem for the church today. We need to stand, and we stand in love. Yeah, I mean, Jesus, you know, he always went to the sinner, but he also called for him to do something we're going to talk about here in a little bit. But as people, we say, I'm offended. Well, why are we offended? They've actually insulted Jesus, okay? Well, he's my king. Yes, but Jesus tells us to show them the love of Jesus, but he tells us to take a stand on what's right and what's wrong. We need to take a stand when lies are being told to innocent children and oh my goodness, today that is very prevalent. Can I say something? Right now, let's give a big hand of thanks and let's always pray for any school teachers, public or private school right now. Let's give a hand of appreciation and pray for them. The ones who will stand up, because some of the things that they're told to be allowed to happen, it's tough. It's tough. They got to show the love of Jesus. Here's these innocent children. Some of their lives get messed up. And when they become adults, they're like, what the world happened to me? Well, because the child doesn't understand. The child doesn't know. There was an old Andy Griffith series on there, and Barney was saying, yeah, you ought to let Opie make up his own mind. And Andy said something like, no, because a child will go for the first thing that glitters, and later on he'll pay the price for it because they don't have the knowledge yet to be able to handle that. So true. We have a responsibility. And so for our teachers who are there, who are in that front ground right there to pray for them, to stand for what's right and what's true and what's noble. You know, some children, they're confused sometimes. It is. It's true. And the powers that be, they want them to believe a lie. They want to believe a lie and not be honest. In the book of Genesis, you know, God, it says that God created them male and female. Boom. That's two genders. And you can say, oh, but they have this gender dysphoria. Then help them. Love them. Tell them the truth. Truth is a way to freedom. And so we must stand up for what's right. And I said, you know, in America, we have a way to help do that. And sometimes it's called an election, which happens in November, where Christians got to look down, measure what is right and what is wrong and what's God saying about it. Who is there somebody who is encouraging this type of behavior? Is there anybody who's standing against it? And Christians need to take a stand. We can't just sit by idly and say, oh, well, we knew the world was going to get worse. We read about it. So we're just going to sit back till Jesus comes and see what it happens. It was Charles J. Chaput who said this, evil preaches tolerance until it is dominant. Then it tries to silence good. Wow. How true it is. Why do we live in a world where we can't have debate? Why? Well, you're mean if you believe this. Really, that's an ignorant people. Do you know that? You know, even if somebody comes to me and says, I don't believe in God, I should listen to what they're saying. How am I going to show them that I believe there is a God? Here is why I believe there is a God. If I don't listen to what they're saying. But in today, the powers that be, oh, no. And if you're smart, if you're wise, if you look at some things that the government told you were so true, so right, and there was no doubt about it, that this is true. And a couple years later, we're finding out, whoops, they were wrong. But they silenced everybody's voice who disagreed with them. And so we need to stand in love. We need to stand in love. And sometimes it's hard because I can get passionate. But God says, love that person. Show them Jesus. But take a stand. Take a stand. And because what happens here is that, you know, the danger in keeping silent is that our innocent children grow up believing in the sinful, crazy life. And they think it's all right in the eyes of God Almighty. And then, just as it was in the church of Pergama, the world creeps right into the church itself. Uh-oh. Yes. Do not get out there holding up hateful posters and protesting certain things. But do not be afraid to take a stand. And do not be afraid to love somebody enough to tell them the truth. And I read this. It says in 1871, an American named Henrik Schleichmann began excavating an ancient city in Turkey. And to the amazement of many, this retired businessman had discovered the lost city of Troy. Today, you can still see the ruins of its towers and its walls, which were 16 feet thick. Woo, imagine that. According to Homer's Iliad, the Greeks besieged Troy for 10 years without success. And after the death of the warrior Achilles, many wanted to give up the fight. But the king of Ithaca, Odysseus, came up with a plan to get the Greek army into Troy. And Odysseus built an immense wooden horse, and he and his warriors hid inside it. And after leaving the horse at the gates of Troy, the Greek army sailed away. And the Trojans, thinking the Greek had given up and had left the horse as a gift, brought it inside the gates. And that night, while the Trojans were sleeping and probably partying too, the Greek ships quietly returned. And the soldiers in the horse slipped out and opened the city gates. And the Greek army quietly entered Troy and started fires all over. over the city. And the Trojans awoke to find their city in flames. And as they tried to flee, they were killed by the waiting Greeks. So the story of the Trojan horse and the fall of Troy has come to represent what happened to the church at Pergamum. And that's for sure. And what is happening to the church in America today? That's what is happening. Satan is wise. He's a sharp old cookie. He's stupid, but he's smart. Okay, that makes sense. In the name of tolerance, sin has made its way into replace holiness. In the name of tolerance, that word has like turned my stomach lately because I'm thinking, well, you just got to tolerate. No, you can love folks, but be careful not to tolerate that God something God condemns. Your life, I'm going to talk about here in a minute, who's king, who's Lord. What Jesus told his church in Pergamum is what he is telling us today. Revelation 2:16, repent, therefore, otherwise I will soon come to you and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth. The word of God. Jesus is lovingly calling us to repent. Do what?
Repent.
Okay, some of y'all sleep out there. To do what?
Repent.
Yeah, to repent. Oh my goodness. It isn't that Jesus is some mean, fun sucker in life. Oh, he just wants us. No. I mean, you know, remember the Lion King video that I showed at the very beginning? In the first part of the message? You know what? And there's animals are supposed to have all come, and that's fictional, and they bow down to the king. And of course, you see that? Well, Jesus is the King of Kings. Jesus is the Lord of Lords. And when he comes with a sharp two-edged sword, nothing else matters. Okay, I'm just saying. Now, you can say, oh, but I feel. Mm-hmm. But what does the Lord say? What does the King of Kings say? Quite a few years ago, I went to my doctor, and he said to me, now, I'm going to tell you something's going to make you angry, but it's my job to make you angry. And he looked at me, and he said, you need to lose some weight. I wish I could have thought quick enough, because I'd have said, do I have to pay my bill? And he'd say, why? Because I didn't get angry, so you didn't do your job. Anyway, why didn't I get angry? Because what he said was true. It was true. I needed to, for my health, I needed to lose some weight. But I didn't want to do what it, you know, I had to do to lose some weight. I mean, I love to eat fried chicken, all right? And a lot of it. I love to eat fried country ham. You know, I love to eat fried bacon. I eat it, I'm telling you. And I love drinking sweet tea. But what the doctor said was true. It was right for my own health. He was right. He was correct. And so we need to realize, as I said earlier, that Jesus speaks. He is the all-powerful, the commander. He is the authoritator. I'm going to use my own word I made up. And it doesn't matter how I feel about something, but this is the way I feel. Can I tell you, your feelings will lead you down the wrong road? Trust me, I still remember I've used this story before. I dated this girl, and then we broke up, and sometime later we got back together, and Mom said, Dave, your heart's going to be broken again. Oh, I didn't feel that. No, Mom was right, okay? Mom was right. Dave's feelings led him off the wrong track. It's not the feelings. You need to have somebody that you live by, something you look to, which should be the Word of God and the Holy Spirit ministering in our lives, telling us what is right and what is wrong. And it doesn't matter how I feel. The church in America as a whole, the church needs to repent. Repent for lying to people just to please people. It's hard. I don't like to upset people. I really don't. I don't like to upset people. I like to see people happy, happy, happy. I like to see them enjoying life. And when somebody is saying something that's against God's Word, though, God is like, Dave, I gave you the job, buddy. You better speak the truth. I'm a little more afraid of him than I am anybody else, okay? I'm just saying, all right? He has more power, and boy, that pulpit's going to get it today. He has more power than any one person, any group of people together. And so he is calling us as a church to stand for what's right. Don't be, you don't have to be right and be hateful and mean. When Jesus called people to repent from their lifestyle, he wasn't mean and hateful. He was not mean and hateful. And it doesn't matter what Dave tells you anyway. You're like, what? It doesn't matter what Dave says. It matters what Jesus says, all right? This is his church. He died for this church. Everything that he says is what matters, not what Dave thinks or what ought to be. God, what do you want said? What's your word say? It's a church. We need to be the loving church, because here's what happened, Revelation 2:17. And I love this. Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who is victorious, I like winning, don't you? I will give some of my hidden manna. I will also give that person a white stone with a new name written on it, known only to the one who receives it. You know, as in past letters, Jesus is saying, listen up. When he says, hey, if you got ears, hear this. He's saying, listen up. Symbolically, I will give you hidden manna. In other words, spiritual food to feast on. And I have a white stone with a new name on it. And so when the world begins to tear you down, remember the promise of Jesus. And this old life, it stinks at times. It does. And I understand temptations. You know, there's some sins I love. Yeah, let's all be honest. Come on, don't lie. There's sins we love, but Jesus says, don't do that. You know, and why? I it's a sinful person inside of me that's fighting, saying, but you'd like to do this, Dave. You'd like, right? And there's just sins I hate. And so the sins we hate, we usually get up on and just thump and preach and scream and yell about. And, you know, but the ones that we're tempted with, oh, they're not quite that bad, are they, Lord? So Jesus is saying, follow me. I am the King of Kings. I am more than the King of the jungle. I am the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And this whole life sometimes stinks and things are handed our way. And a lot of times we make mistakes and there is mercy and there is grace with God. And so there is a prize that is awaiting. Now, Davy and Amanda live in an old farmhouse that Tammy and I lived in. And we pretty much raised our kids in that farmhouse. And it was built somewhere in the late 1800s. And I like old farmhouses. And we'd remodeled it. And they've done a lot of things in there. And so... if you have to do any work in that crawl space, it is tight and it is dirty. Oh my goodness. I was up underneath there some of you all that maybe do some of your own work, but Davey needed a gas line run. And DW, he wasn't happy about doing it because I have never been back to the part where you have to do it because it is very tight. And there are spider webs everywhere. And I used to think when I get up underneath there, if a snake pops up, how am I getting away from that thing? That's what I'm thinking, you know. So DW, he wasn't crazy about doing it. I don't blame him. I wouldn't have been either. And even if he offered D-Dub $50, he's like, nope, ain't doing that. Just like he told me one time he wasn't going to drive my farm all tractor, tricycle tractor. I said, why not? He said, that's a stupid way to die on that tricycle tractor. I said, I wouldn't let you get on a hillside. But anyway, so he Davey calls up Wyatt, Danielle's son, who's 9 years old. And he said, would you crawl up underneath this house for $50? Oh, Wyatt said, I'm going on vacay next week. That's what he said. I can use that for my vacation. That's where they are today. They left for vacation. He said, yeah, I'll do it. And so Davey got down there and he shined the light there at the opening to the crawl space. DW is up on top, shined the light down through the hole was of the floor. And so, you know, Wyatt accomplishes the goal. And there's a picture of Wyatt up there. And you can see the cobwebs all over his face and everything. And so, you know, you can see he's very dirty. But Davey said, here's the thing. Davey said that as he was holding that light, he could hear Wyatt saying, $50, $50, $50. You see, that's what kept him going. Friends, you know what? In our spiritual lives, when we feel like giving up, when we feel like it's too tough, when we feel like we can't take a stand, we need to say this to ourselves, a new life, a new life, a new life, a new life, and just keep right on going. Because we might come out with cobwebs and filth all over us, but we will accomplish what Jesus wants us to accomplish. Church, let's be a loving church. Let's love those who've been lost in sin. And sometimes they're there because they have so much turned their back on God that God says, that's what you want. That's what God don't force you to do anything. He says, if that's what you want, okay. But you really don't want to go down that road, okay? But some of us make mistakes in life. And sometimes some mistakes seem bigger than others, big consequences. Sin is sin, but there's these consequences. But here's God. He loves each and every one of us. He knows our name. I try hard to remember people's names. I was told years ago in youth ministry by Kevin Greer, who was a director for CIY, when one time he called me by name a year after he'd seen me. I'm thinking, how in the world does that guy remember my name? I can remember him. He's a director. And then he taught us, he's like, remember young people's names, because when you call them by name, there's something special about that. They know they are somebody. And I try hard to remember people's names. I still said I remember the first day the Vasquez family came in here. And they had a whole row of them. I'm thinking, dear Lord, how am I going to remember these names? And they ain't from West Virginia. So them names ain't going to be as easy as John and Tom and everything else. But, you know, that name is important. That name is important. And Jesus knows our name. He knows what we're going through. In church, he calls for us to take the stand. Not in a mean way. It's not mean to tell the truth. It's just how you tell the truth sometimes can be. But we want to direct people to Jesus. He's the King. More so than, what is it, Mustafa or something like that? I should know. I got grandchildren, you know. But anyway, more so than him. and we want to follow his direction. As a church, that's who we want to be. We want to be a loving church, but a church who is true. And you know, in this old life, you can go down the wrong path, and God, like I said, he'll let you go there. But really, truthfully, the only hope is in Jesus. And I love to tell people this. How to succeed in being a Christian is this. Don't quit. Don't quit. But I fell down. I did something so terrible. Don't quit. Get back up. Get back up. Because Jesus is not turning his back on you and spitting on you. He's reaching down and he knows your name. And he says, John, I want to help you up. Scott, I want to help you up. Betty, I want to help you up. He knows our names. He knows what we're going through. He knows, Tyler, I want to help you up. I'm going to keep you moving. He knows that. He knows these things. Chris, I want to help you up. He knows what we're going through and he loves us. So church, let's be what he wants us to be. Let's stand for truth and stand in love so that the world can say, what do you got? Because I'd like to have it. And we can say, Jesus is my king. In him, he is a living hope. He is our only hope. And that's the song we're going to sing right now. And that's the truth. And if you don't know him, don't leave here today without knowing him. We can talk to you about it. If you need prayer, there's people in the corners of our rooms. And they could pray with you. I'll be down front. Maybe today is the day like I'm accepting Jesus. I'm going to be baptized. We're ready. Whatever it is, don't put it off. Let's be standing and let's pray. Father, you're an amazing God. And I thank you that you're real. You're true. And I know in our world today it's tough. We kind of think, well, we can go anyway, and whatever we say is truth, and that's so untrue. And it's destructive for us, and you love us, and you don't want that for us. Help us to be a church that stands for truth and stands in love. And God, I pray for anybody here, whatever struggles, I know you know what they are. And God, we thank you for answered prayer for folks who are here today. And God, we're praying for others who are hurting, but most of all, we pray for people spiritually. They'll come to know this awesome God. It's in Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Romans 15:13, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the written, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus.
and a morning that seal the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. Oh, hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation.
You know, he is our living hope, no matter where we've been. And in love, we want to be the church that tells the truth in love. Because it makes no difference what I say. It's what happens when you go before the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Just very quickly in closing, last week I did a funeral. And at that funeral, the daughter called me and said, tell me a little bit about your, and I said, tell me a little bit about your mother. And I talked to the lady's brother. And both of them said the same thing. In the last couple of years, her life began to change. She began to turn to God. There's some stuff she did in her past that was kind of rough, but she began to turn to God. And her daughter said, Mom used to tell me, you do as I say, not as I do. But in the last few years of her life, my mom began to set the example. And she began to worship God more. She became a follower of Jesus Christ. And I'm so thankful. She went to a concert a couple weeks ago and heard that song, Scars in Heaven, and how it ministered to her heart. And today, because of that changed life and what God can do for her, she can say, death has no power over me, because Jesus is my living hope. And that's the message we want to spread to the world today. We want to be living hope, that message. We don't want to be a lamp stand for the light that is Jesus.
Amen. Thank you for worshiping with us. I will pray us out. Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for being a God of hope. Thank you for being a God of faithfulness. Many of us are going through seasons of loss, whether it is physical loss of a loved one, loss of a job, loss of a relationship, loss of a marriage, loss of our peace, loss of identity. Whatever that season may be, Lord, thank you for showing your face. Thank you because you are the God of hope. Thank you that we have a cross that we can come to anytime to lay those things at your feet. May we go through our week knowing that you are in control, no matter what the circumstances are. May we have the boldness, yet the tenderness to show Jesus to those that we encounter. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.